One little known but very spooky reality of our world is that life itself evolved here under somewhat different circumstances than we have today. We do not live on Earth as it was in the early days. This extends beyond the Earth as well. When life arose on Earth, or when it appears to have done so, this planet was very different. But so was the solar system. Some of the planets were probably not in the positions they are today yet. And the sun itself was not as bright as it is now. Stellar physics for a star like the sun are very clear in this regard. As it ages, it brightens. And in the early days of life on Earth, it was significantly dimmer than it is today. We do not currently know why Earth was not a frozen ice ball in those days, and somehow could allow for life to arise. There could be any number of reasons for this, volcanism being an important thing to consider. Whether one suspects life first arose near hydrothermal vents in the oceans, or in volcanic environments on land, or some combination thereof, that all means heat, and heat means no ice, at least locally. It's possible to contemplate a very situational Earth that was mostly frozen, but the hot spots of its geology kept enough going as far as liquid water for the magic to occur. But the sun should not have been bright enough in the early days to sustain things as it does today. It was on the order of 30% dimmer. But Earth was also hotter during this period, still cooling from its formation, so there must have been some balance struck that allowed for life to arise, or alternatively support life getting seeded here through panspermia from meteorites from somewhere else, wherever that might be, which were much more abundant in those days and had not yet been mostly gobbled up by the worlds of the star system. Who knows what was deposited elsewhere? This actually creates an unusual set of circumstances for contemplating life in the universe, not like that which we have on Earth. If those specific circumstances Earth went through when life appears here were not common to exoplanets, that creates a great filter, but only potentially. The reality is that most stars in the universe are dimmer than the sun, and if they too could spark off life, then the question of dim suns is not a huge problem. But it may involve alternative biochemistries we do not have on this planet, and that could be a problem for aliens coming to this world. In the wrong circumstances chemically, an alien setting foot on Earth could explode. When we think of alien first contact, we often do it from the standpoint of past science fiction, for better or worse. I'm not actually sure we would recognize actual first contact until after we saw it. Perhaps long after, when we finally figured out what exactly that was that we saw. We see those potentials now. We still have no idea exactly what is going on at places like Tabby's star or Jabilski's star. But in fiction, on the one hand, were the aliens of Star Trek, that were basically humanoid except in a few cases, and ultimately held a lot of common ground with us, even if their suns they evolved around were different. There were some deviations, who could forget the Horta of the original series that was silicon-based, that Dr. McCoy had to glue a piece back onto. But in other cases in sci-fi, the aliens have been very different. There wasn't much common ground between Ellen Ripley and the xenomorph aliens, other than perhaps violence, but we still understood it as an alien nonetheless. What happens if you can't even recognize that? At the same time, while that alien species was very acidic in its biochemical secretions, it was still existing in the same atmosphere as Ripley was, a presumably normal Earth oxygen-nitrogen mix. How much power your star is producing here, however, plays into how an atmosphere is. But that brings up a very interesting point about actual alien life, because oxygen is extremely reactive. Indeed, the advent of large amounts of oxygen on planet Earth was not geological, it was biological, the appearance of photosynthesis. And it was a gigantic extinction event when it showed up. This is often not said about the oxygenation of the Earth's atmosphere, but it's actually one of the largest, actually probably the largest, mass extinction this world has ever seen. But it was not an extinction as we normally see it. There we usually think of plants and animals going extinct, but indeed microorganisms can go extinct as well. And here, many may well have during that great oxygenation event. We don't entirely know because these types of organisms that existed that early the great oxygenation event began about 2.5 billion years ago were like. We know some, but not really much, about the individual species that were present and may have disappeared without a trace due to oxygen poisoning. This is just not well represented in the fossil record for a number of reasons. Much of this life survived, however. It's the anaerobic microorganisms, and they retreated deep below the surface of the Earth, out of sight of the sun, and other places where oxygen is poor. And the reason they have to do that is oxygen's reactivity. It's a poison to them. And had photosynthesis on this world not developed, they would have continued to dominate the biology of the Earth. The problem is that they may have had another severe restriction, however. Again, this is because of the reactivity of oxygen. It's one of the things that drive our mammalian biology, and more importantly, our huge brains that can build spacecraft and cars. But when we look at Earth as it was chemically before the advent of photosynthesis, it's difficult to see how life could have gotten very complex from the anaerobes. That reactivity of oxygen was key to animals, though the plants did evolve in that previous atmosphere, and perhaps abundant plant life might be on the table for exoplanets, but at the same time, that which drives their energy to become as complex as they are today came about as a result of the process that is producing the oxygen. So oxygenation may be the inevitable end result of plants, or analogs of them, appearing on a world. But that's a far cry from getting stalked by a xenomorph. Indeed, there have been complex, intelligent aliens that are plants in science fiction. Perhaps the most famous example being the story Who Goes There by John W. Campbell, which later became both film versions of The Thing. And both movies and the short story are equally terrifying. John Carpenter's version is certainly spooky. Let's call it the JMG Spooky Season of the Month movie. But I actually grew up and was first spooked by the 1951 version, The Thing from Another World, one of my dad's favorite movies. And there was just something about the black and white film of those days that made it seem even more spooky, almost like it happened in the distant past when it really wasn't. Campbell's original short story, written under the pen name Don Stewart, is inevitably even better. But the idea of a plant-based creature that could be that mobile and proactive and survive and operate pretty well in an oxygen environment isn't particularly realistic. Remember, Campbell published that story in 1938, the very same year Orson Welles and the Mercury Theater gave their famous Halloween broadcast of the War of the Worlds, and reportedly spooked a number of people at the very least. But at the same time, you'd think such a creature would need sunlight, presumably a lot of it, perhaps a type F star more luminous than the sun. But therein is a problem, more on that in a bit. In the War of the Worlds, the problem wasn't the oxygen for the aliens, but the microbes. Earth's microbiome defeats the aliens in that story, not the humans, and that's another story entirely. The microbes themselves can be defeated by too bright of a sun that turns its planet's surfaces into molten oceans. But back to the oxygen. Given that its reactivity led to us, are there any other elements in the periodic table that could behave that way? And more importantly, become the basis of intelligent alien brains? The answer is yes, but it's less likely, but not impossible. One answer is fluorine. Fluorine is spooky. It's number 9 on the periodic table, and usually exists as a gas in elemental form, just like oxygen. And it is the most electronegative element on the periodic table, meaning it very strongly attracts electrons in chemical bonds. We use fluorine in industry. Indeed, compounds of it include things like Teflon. It's useful, but extremely dangerous. Indeed, fluorine is one of the most toxic elements to human life on that periodic table. Humans would switch places with the anaerobic microorganisms in such an atmosphere rich in fluorine, and very rapidly go extinct if we stood on an exoplanet with too much of that gas in the atmosphere. Even at small amounts, fluorine is rough on a human. It's very irritating to the eyes and skin, and the lungs. If the concentration is too high, it becomes impossible to breathe and lung damage and death rapidly occur. But that too is because it's highly reactive, like oxygen. Interestingly, fluorine in this context actually does appear in sci-fi as well, one prominent example being Star Trek, First Contact, where the crew of the Enterprise sees a Borg-dominated version of Earth, and Mr. Data detects fluorine gas in the atmosphere. Perhaps the Borg had a reason for that, as chemically dangerous as that might have been. Fluorine gas and water can be a violently bad combination in that scenario. In fact, fluorine, and the chemist can correct me if I'm wrong here, but it will react with anything in the periodic table of the elements except helium and neon. It will even react with gold. In this way, the element is so reactive that it's almost evil in what it can do, and there are chemists that don't like working with it. But it can get locked up in compounds and become things like fluoride, famously and controversially added to water for tooth health. Regardless of that, that's a lot of energy there in fluorine's elemental form, with that kind of reactivity. But the question is it too reactive for life as a basis of energy? It turns out there may be a path. In a 2014 paper by Budisa and colleagues, link in the description below, there may actually be a way for some kind of biology to work in a fluorine-rich exoplanet atmosphere. Here it depends on the solvent and other very special circumstances. Our life works with water as a solvent, but it pays to remember here that while water is very common in the universe, and fluorine is not that common, water can be really problematic in some chemistry with fluorine. But there are other liquid solvents that might offer possibilities, but they seem like they would be scarce or really rare. I leave that up to you, but the point is, such an organism is not likely to be able to exist in the atmosphere of the Earth. But again, we come back to the luminosity of suns. That too changes the equation. The biospheres of life around different stars or even subtypes within the sun's G-class could dramatically change the equation of what can happen. One very huge one is photosynthesis and the generation of oxygen, which may play a large role in what life on other worlds can do. You may need oxygen. Remember, fluorine reacts with almost anything to get fluorine life to work. Geology can produce oxygen, and there are lots of chemical paths for it. But one is the plants, and here is the great mystery. Photosynthesis on Earth shuts down in the presence of too much light. And indeed, photosynthetic life on Earth tends to ignore or reflect the strongest light from our sun. This is green light, actually. Some have called the sun a green giant, despite its color from space being white. There is a lot of green light there, very energetic for plants, and the reason they are green is to reflect it. They don't much use it, preferring red and blue, as gardeners that use grow lights will know. So at the brightest times of the day on this world, the plants generally shut down photosynthesis. They are already sensitive to the power of the sun, very much so. Too little doesn't really affect life at its most general. The anaerobes will persist. But too little, many plants can't handle. Too much, however, and photosynthesis shuts down. Too much more, and the environments of the subsurface anaerobic life melt. They too die as a result. As this happens, Earth will lose its oxygen. It will take several million years for it all to react away, but as the sun's luminosity increases, it will. There may be reprieves as the oceans evaporate, but water vapor is a greenhouse gas and traps heat. So no matter what you do, this world will die with a brighter sun. Is there a way out for alternative biochemistries? Maybe, or at least a reprieve. But for Earth, the day photosynthesis shuts down will be the herald of the extinction of all life on Earth. And there is no question, this world will heat up because of the sun. What does that mean for other life that might be out there in the universe? We don't know. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently addressing why spooky season videos are slowed down. They're going to extend into November because of mitigating personal circumstances. Not great, but it isn't me directly, just a few of the people close to me. And I'm sure a great many of you know how that is. But I'm good, and onward we go. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channel's regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.